Hi there friends. Now see, in the previous videos we talked of sole proprietorship, and then we talked of a type of sole proprietorship called Hindu undivided family. Now we saw okay, in sole proprietorship there are some limitations. First would be limitation of capital, money to start or expand the business. Second limitation would be limitation of managing the business. Because as the business expands, it is very hard for one person to take care of entire business, all his aspects, right? Monitor and control and take all decisions. It's very tough for one person. At the same time, a single person cannot be an expert in many fields. So, wouldn't it be better that, let us say, some people come together, people having expertise in different fields, better would be they come together and they start a business combined. So that would be a partnership. Each partner would bring his expertise to the business, and collectively they could manage and grow the business. So it would overcome many limitations of sole proprietorship. Right? So basically that is it. Okay, if you want to make a business large, if you want to take it to a large scale business, then partnership is better, because it will help to remove the limitations of sole proprietorship. Which limitations? Huge capital, efficient administrative power, and more risk bearing capacity, because you have more risk taking power, right? You have more capital. And you can bear more losses. And the main thing is better administrative setup. So, let us define partnership. Right? What's the meaning of partnership? Partnership is such a business system in which the owner of the business remains with, sorry, the ownership of the business, the ownership of the business remains with more than one person, and in the same way the business is managed by all or by one or more on behalf of all partners. So according to the Indian Partnership Act of 1932, please remember this, the Indian Partnership Act of 1932, partnership is a relation between such persons who have agreed to share the profit of business, which is run by all or by one person on behalf of all. Right? Please learn this definition of partnership. Let us look at the characteristics of partnership in this video. Okay, and then we'll proceed further. So the first characteristic of partnership is that it is a relation by agreement. Right? See, it comes into existence by an agreement between the partners. This agreement can be written or it can be oral. It can be registered, it can be unregistered. Right? It's an agreement. But it is always preferable to have a written agreement, because then it is legally binding. And not only a written agreement, it should be a registered legal agreement. Means when you register your partnership firm under the Partnership Act, then it is legally binding. So then if for any disputes or to settlement of any disputes, you can go for legal recourse. If it's an oral agreement, then you cannot approach the court of law regarding any dispute, because you have no proof regarding this. So because it's between many people, it has an establishment procedure. But it is comparatively simple. It is simpler than company format. It is much simpler than a joint stock company. It is little complex than a sole proprietorship. Right? So there is no long procedure of law. There is no complex procedure. Registration is not compulsory. Right? So it is not compulsory to register a partnership firm. But if you want to register, registration can be done by the registrar of firms, to whom the partnership deed is submitted for registration. We will talk of the partnership deed later on. But it is advisable. Whenever you form a partnership firm, it is advisable to get all your paperwork together. Normally what happens is that, let's say some friends, 3-4 friends get together. And one fine day, they are sitting over at their homes, right, watching a match, a movie, or just passing their time, and they are having snacks. And somebody says, "Let's start a partnership firm. Let us start a business. Let's do this. Let's do that." And in this excitement, they get together and they put their money together and their efforts together and start the business. If things go fine, well and good. If things start going downhill, problems start coming. People start fighting. And at times the friendship also breaks. Or if things even go better than expected, still problems can arise of division of profits. Right? Initially, everyone is in enthusiasm. They are in a forgiving nature. Gradually that thing will come. I work more and you work less and this and that, and all the problems start coming. Jhagra chalo ho jata hai, right? It is much better to register the firm then, initial stage only, so that in case in future any problem arises, still there is a legal recourse left. And at the same time, everything is on paper. You've decided everything. All division of work is clear cut. Number of partners, if we take, so in a partnership firm, the minimum number of partners is 2. Oh yeah, remember, minimum is 2. According to the Companies Act of 2013, clause number 462, number of partners in a partnership firm cannot be more than 100 members. So, and now as per the government decision, according to Companies Act, now see, there's a change. According to Companies Act of 2014, the amendment of 2014, clause number 10, under miscellaneous rule, number of maximum partners in partnership firm is 50. So initially, you can see by till 2012 it was 100 members. Now we are 250. So we have 2 members to 50 members, right? These are the number of members possible in a partnership firm. The purpose of partnership firm is to carry out lawful business activity to earn profit. See, it's a business activity. An activity without profit, any activity without profit is not partnership. So social service and religious activity are legal, but their purpose is not to earn profit, so it is not partnership. So if 5 friends get together and say, let us collect food from our neighborhood, or let us collect donation and help feed the stray dogs of the area. It's a social service. It's a voluntary act. Though these friends are working in tandem, they are working together with a common goal, but the goal is not to earn profit. The goal is for a good service. In this case, feeding stray dogs. So we cannot say it's a partnership firm. It's not a partnership firm. It's only a joint activity, okay? Then, capital requirement. See, generally, all partners will bring capital. See, I remember the word is generally, because sometimes some partner may not bring capital, may not invest money, but they may invest time or expertise, right? So, there are different types of partnership. It is not necessary, it is not necessary for all partners to bring capital. Right? Partners bring the capital as shown in partnership deed. Or a partner may decide not to give any money. Still, he may be a partner. That's again agreement between the partners. The partners may decide among themselves what to do. There's no fixed guideline for that. Management. All the partners can manage the firm. See, all partners manage the firm jointly. All partners have right to take part in the decision-making process. But some partners may say, I am not involved in the decision making process. I'm a sleeping partner. Yet I'm an inactive partner. So in the partnership deed itself, you can mention, you can give power to one partner or more than one partner to take agreement, to take part in the management. The remain partners may remain as sleeping partners or inactive partners. The liability of partners, all partners, is unlimited. Like in sole proprietorship, the liability of the proprietor is unlimited. Same way in partnership, the liability of all the partners is unlimited. So all the partners will have to sell their private property for payment of debt. Again, there's a sub clause in this. Okay, suppose a partner is there who joins the company, or let's say three partners are already there and they are running the company. Now one of the employees is a very nice, loyal employee and very efficient, and you want to keep him with you for a long time. You don't want him running away to your competition. He is indispensable to you. So better would be, rather than raising his salary, better would be to offer him partnership. But in this case, that man will say, oh, I'm a poor person. What if loss occurs to you? I will not be able to bear any loss. I would like to be a partner, but I cannot be a partner in your debt, in your debts or in your losses. Then the partners may also agree that this particular partner, we take him as a partner, but he is not liable to pay any debt, outstanding debts of the company. Right? So in the partnership deed, you can provide such immunity to any partner. Right? So if one of the partners is unable to pay the debt from his personal property, the rest of the partners have to pay the debts from their personal property. So this is one thing. If all partners have unlimited liability, one cannot pay, the others are bound to pay. Partners cannot say, uski 25% ka mai jawabdari hai, he'll pay 25%, we are not responsible. That is not it. But what I told you also applies. Okay, if some partner is not in the having unlimited liability, we can mention that in the partnership deed itself. And then that person is exempt from liability. Then in case of ownership, partnership firm, the transfer of ownership is not easy, right? Transfer of ownership is not easy. Why? Because with the consent of all partners is required. So without the consent of all partners, any partner cannot transfer his share in favor of other person. Right? If any partner transfers his share without the consent of all partner, then any partner can bring dissolution of the firm. Right? So if I suppose one partner wants to sell away his share to some person, Mr. X, but the other partners don't want Mr. X to join the firm, then Mr. X cannot take cannot join the firm as a new partner. The consent of all partners is required. But let us say one partner wants to exit the firm, and the person who is willing to take his share, the other partners don't want him to join. In such a case, the partnership firm will have to dissolve. You have to end up this partnership firm and form a new one then. So transfer of ownership is not easy, because it will have to be by consent of all other partners. Legal status. Indian Partnership Act of 1932 will clarify the partner's rights, duties, rules, registration of firm, as well as other provisions. But a partnership firm is a legal entity if and only if the partnership firm is registered. If it is an unregistered partnership firm, then there's no legal binding for it. And the lifespan of partnership firm depends on the life of the partners. So it's a limited lifespan, because if any partner loses mental balance, means turns insane, he dies or is declared insolvent, then partnership comes to end. Right? The remaining partners, with their mutual consent, can distribute the share of such partner among themselves or admit a new partner. Right? You can remove that partner by giving him his share, or you can admit a new partner and remove and settle the accounts of that old partner. So partnership yet can come to end. See, partnership can come to end. Partnership firm may continue, may not be dissolved. Okay, so these are the characteristics of partnership. We'll talk of the advantages and limitations in the next video. Bye.